John Gielgud, Michael Hordern, Joan Greenwood, and Simon Ward as Smith.
No, 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 with a P. P-S-M-I-T-H. I should explain to you that I started life without the initial letter. My father always clung ruggedly to the plain Smith. But it seemed to me that there were so many Smiths in the world that a little variety might be introduced. The P, I should add for your guidance, is silent, as in Tisis, Psychic, and Ptarmigan. You follow me?
Leave It to Smith, dramatized by Michael Bakewell, from the novel by P.G. Wodehouse.
This, just in case any of you have been misled by the title, is one of the Blandings stories. It is unique in the Chronicles of Blandings in that it contains neither Lord Emsworth's captive balloon of a pig, the Empress, nor his irrepressible brother Galahad. But it does contain Smith. Blandings, a kind of earthly paradise. It's quite close to where my parents used to live in Shropshire, and the Blandings Chronicles have multiplied like rabbits down the years since I first hit on the idea in a moment of desperation in 1915. In my childhood, I had met with earls and butlers and younger sons in some profusion, and it struck me that the slick magazines would like to read about them. They did. The saga you are going to hear tonight was written on Long Island in 1922 in a place reveling in the name of Great Neck. Clarence, 9th Earl of Emsworth, whose manner I have frequently compared to a wet sock, is in a melancholy condition. He looks blearily out over his beautiful gardens, but his heart does not rejoice.
Just a blur. Can't make out a thing.
For he's lost his glasses, and without them is as blind as a bat.
Who's that?
It is I, your lordship, Beach.
Ah, Beach. Yeah. Have you found him?
I have searched assiduously, your lordship, but without avail. Thomas and Charles also announce non-success. Stokes has not yet made his report. I am redispatching Thomas and Charles to your lordship's bedroom. I trust that their efforts will be rewarded.
Blind as a dratted bat.
Hello, Governor. Here you've lost your glasses.
That is so.
Nuisance, what?
Undeniably.
Ought to have a spare pair.
Broken my spare pair.
Oh, tough luck. And lost the other.
And, as you say, lost the other.
Have you looked for the belly thing?
I have.
Must be somewhere, I mean.
Quite possibly.
Where did you see them last?
Go away.
Eh?
Go away.
Go away?
Yes, go away.
Right-o.
Oh, goodness. Blind as a dratted bat.
Earls, butlers, and younger sons. See what I mean? But every Garden of Eden must have its serpent. And into Lord Emsworth's paradise, I decided to introduce Rupert Baxter, efficient, steel-rimmed, the brains of Blandings.
Lord Emsworth?
Ah, Baxter, my dear fellow. I've lost my glasses. I've mislaid them. I can't think where they've gone to. You haven't seen them anywhere, by any chance?
Yes, Lord Emsworth. They are hanging down your back.
Down my back? Why? Why, bless my soul, why? Bless my soul, so they are. Thank you, Baxter, thank you. You're invaluable. Now, where's that brute MacAllister? What? What is it, Baxter?
The car will be at the door at 2 sharp.
Car? What car?
The car to take you to the station.
Station? What station?
You have perhaps forgotten, Lord Emsworth, that you arranged with Lady Constance to go to London this afternoon.
Go to London? In weather like this? I've got to have a serious talk to MacAllister about the hollyhocks. Why should I go to London? I hate London.
You arranged with Lady Constance that you would give Mr. McTodd lunch tomorrow at your club.
Who the devil is McTodd?
The well-known Canadian poet.
Never heard of him.
Lady Constance has long been an admirer of his work. She wrote inviting him, should he ever come to London, to pay a visit to Blandings. He is now in London and is to come down tomorrow for 2 weeks. Lady Constance suggested that as a compliment to Mr. McTodd's eminence in the world of literature, you should meet him in London and bring him back here yourself.
It's a perfectly preposterous idea. Am I expected to leave Blandings in weather like this and entertain some wretched poet fella? Just because Connie's taken it into her head to... hello, Connie.
There you are, Clarence.
Before we go any further, I'd better have a word with you about Lady Constance. She is one of that monstrous regiment of women, Lord Emsworth's sisters. They vary in size, shape, and complexion, but they have this in common. They can all reduce Lord Emsworth to a craven, apologetic heap. Constance, when thwarted, behaves like Cleopatra on one of her bad days.
Look here, Connie.
If you will excuse me, I have one or two things to attend to.
Of course, Mr. Baxter.
Look here, Connie. You know I hate literary fellows. It's bad enough having them hanging about the house like that Peavy woman, but when it comes to going to London...
Clarence?
I never could stand literary fellows, and... By Jove, literary females are worse. Miss Peavy? Who is Miss Peavy?
My dear Clarence, if you do not know that Miss Peavy is one of the leading poetesses of the younger school...
No, I don't mean that. I mean, who is she? Where did you find her?
I first made Aileen's acquaintance on Atlantic Liner when Joe and I were coming back from our trip round the world. She was very kind to me when I was feeling the motion of the vessel.
Yeah, but who is she?
If you mean, what is her family? I think she once told me she was connected with the Rutlandshire Peavys.
I never heard of them. If they're anything like Miss Peavy, God help Rutlandshire.
Excuse me. I forgot to mention, Lord Emsworth, that to suit everybody's convenience, I've arranged that Miss Halliday shall call to see you at your club tomorrow after lunch.
Who's Miss Halliday? Another literary female?
Miss Halliday is the young lady who is coming to Blandings to catalogue the library.
Catalogue the library? What's he want cataloguing for?
It has not been done since the year 1885.
Quite.
Well, look how splendidly we've got on without it.
No, don't be ridiculous, Clarence. The catalogue of a great library like this must be brought up to date. I do wish you would try and wake up and take an interest in things. If it wasn't for Mr. Baxter, I don't know what would happen.
I have written to Miss Halliday suggesting 2:30 as a suitable time for the interview.
Oh, but look here, Baxter, it's out of the question. I can't possibly leave Blandings. The weather may break at any moment. I don't want to miss a day of it.
The arrangements are all made.
Send a wire. Unavoidably detained.
Possibly if you were to make the suggestion to Lady Constance.
Dash it. Well, if I've got to go, I've got to go. But to leave my garden and go and stew in London at this time of year.
Connie!
No! I was going into the garden.
Come into the smoking room a minute. I want to talk to you.
Well, Joe, what is it?
Connie, I've been thinking about that necklace again.
Oh, don't be so silly, Joe. You haven't called your wife into this stuffy room on a lovely morning to talk about that for the 100th time.
But, Connie, there's no sense in taking risks.
No, don't be absurd. What risks can there be?
There was a burglary over at Winston Court a day or two ago, and that's not 10 miles from here.
No, don't be so fussy, Joe.
That necklace cost me nearly £20,000.
I know, Joe, I know.
It ought to be in the bank.
Once and for all, I will not keep that necklace in a bank. What on earth is the use of having a beautiful necklace if it's lying in the strong room of a bank all the time? There's the county ball coming on. I need it. Do stop worrying me about it.
I'm sorry, Connie. Don't get worked up. That wasn't what I wanted to talk to you about anyway.
Connie,
had a letter from Phyllis this morning. She says in her letter that young Jackson has got the chance of buying a big farm in Lincolnshire, I think she said, if he can raise £3,000. So I was just thinking. It just crossed my mind. It isn't if it were speculation. It occurred to me, and they would pay us good interest on the loan.
What loan?
Well, I was thinking, but just a suggestion, you know. What struck me was that if you were willing, we might... I was thinking we might lend them the money.
We had better settle this thing once and for all, Joe. As you know, when we were married, I was ready to do everything for your stepdaughter. I was prepared to be a mother to her. I gave her every chance, I took her everywhere, and what happened?
Yes, I know, but...
I found her a perfectly presentable man with plenty of money.
Shocking young ass and a rip, what's more, I've heard stories.
Nonsense. He was a delightful young man and would have made Phyllis perfectly happy. Instead of marrying him, she chose to go off with this Jackson. You may think she can do no wrong, but after what has happened, I intend to have nothing to do with her. We will not lend her a penny. So please do not let us continue this discussion any longer. I'm going for a walk in the garden. Was there anything else you wanted to talk to me about?
No, Connie. No.
Very well, Joe.
Oh, damn. What am I going to tell Phyllis? That I'm a weak-kneed, spineless creature who's too afraid of his wife to touch his own money? Oh, how on earth am I to put it to her? My dear Phyllis. Oh.
Hello, Uncle Joe.
Freddy, how did you get in here?
Dropped in through the window. I say, Uncle Joe...
Well, what is it?
I say, Uncle Joe, can you lend me £1,000?
Oh!
Half a jiffy. I say, don't go off the deep end for just a second. I can explain.
Explain?
Well, the whole trouble was I started at the wrong end. Shouldn't have sprung it on you like that. The fact is, Uncle Joe... I've got a scheme, and if you can only put off having apoplexy for about 3 minutes, I can shove you onto a good thing.
Go on.
Well, look here. You know all the trouble there's been about my dropping a bit on the races lately.
I do.
Well, I've put a lot of thought into it, and I've realised that the reason I lost all that stuff was simply because I was on the wrong side of the fence. Mm. The only way to make money is to be a bookie, and that's what I'm going to do. If you'll part with £1,000. There's a pal of mine who was up at Oxford with me. He's in a bookie's office, and they're going to take me in too if I can put up £1,000.
Do you seriously suppose I would? But what's the use of wasting time talking? I have no means of laying hands on a sum you mentioned. If I had...
Oh, I know how you're situated, Uncle Joe, and I'm dashed sorry for you. I mean, Aunt Constance and all that...
What do you mean?
Well, I know that Aunt Constance keeps an eye on the doubloons. I think it's a dash shame she won't unbuckle to help poor old Phyllis.
How did you...
Barely shame. I mean, love's love.
But how did you...
I was having a quiet after-breakfast smoke outside the window there and heard the whole thing.
Window? Window? You... You listen.
And dash lucky for you that I did, because I've got a scheme.
A scheme? You mean you've got a scheme to... Do you mean you've got a scheme to get me out of my difficulty?
Absolutely, Uncle Joe. Now, you remember what you were saying to Aunt Constance about some bird being apt to sneak up and pinch her necklace?
I do.
Well, why not?
What do you mean?
I mean, why don't you?
Steal my wife's necklace?
That's it. Pinch Aunt Connie's necklace. For mark you, if a husband pinches anything from his wife, it isn't stealing. That's law. I found that out from a movie I saw in town.
Are you insane?
Well, it wouldn't be hard for you to get hold of it. All you'd have to do then would be to draw a cheque to pay for another one for Aunt Connie, which would make her perfectly chirpy as well as putting you one up, if you follow me. Then you could slip Phyllis her 3,000 or whatever, push across my 1,000, and what would be left over would be a nice private little account for you to tuck away somewhere Aunt Constance couldn't know anything about it. And a dash useful thing to have up your sleeve in case of emergency.
You must be off your... No, wait a minute. Could it really be done? Is it feasible?
Feasible? Why, dash it, what the dickens is there to stop you?
But what if Connie were to find out? Your aunt would have a good deal to say.
Well, you would have to risk that.
Freddy, my boy, I daren't do it.
Oh, I say, don't be such a rabbit.
No, I daren't.
By Jove, I'll tell you what.
Not so loud.
I'll tell you what. How would it be if I did the pinching?
What?
How would it be if I...
Would you, my boy, would you really?
For £1,000, you bet I would.
Freddy, the moment you place that necklace in my hands, I will give you not 1,000, but £2,000.
Uncle Joey! Oh, it's a bet.
Do you think you can manage it?
Manage it? Just watch me.
Good. Then tonight I will write to Phyllis and say that I may be able to do what she wishes.
But don't say may. The word is will. Bally will, whatever.
I must go out and get some fresh air.
Righty-ho.
But where, you will be asking after all this time, is Smith? The word goes round the shires. Wodehouse is off the rails again. But have no fear, he is not forgotten. I decided that Freddy would rapidly lose that first fine flush of exhilaration.
What if I'm caught in the belly act? I mean, it's all very well that a husband can't be caught for filching his wife's jewels, but a nephew is a vastly different kettle of fish. Hello? What's this? Leave it to Psmith. Psmith? Psmith will help you. Psmith is ready for anything. Do you want someone to manage your affairs, someone to manage your business, someone to take the dog for a walk, someone to assassinate your aunt? Psmith will do it. Crime not objected to. I say, this sounds the real thing. Whatever job you have to offer, provided it has nothing to do with fish... Fish? Leave it to Psmith. Address applications to R. Psmith, Box 365. It's like the answer to a prayer.
Smith had been the hero of a story I'd written for boys in 1909, in the days when my hair was plentiful and golden. My daughter kept nagging at me to revive him. I tried him in the city and gave him a run as a journalist, but until then I'd never thought of getting him down to Blandings. Smith is a strong character, and he certainly tends to run away with any story he's in. Well, see for yourselves. He's standing at the window of the Drones Club, staring at an exceptionally pretty and very well-dressed young lady sheltering from the rain under the awning of Thorpe and Briscoe, coal merchants of Dover Street.
What an indescribably jolly young lady. And that hat... But what's she doing marooned outside a coal shop? Chauffeur taking the day off? Ours not to reason why. What that girl needs is an umbrella.
Riggs?
Yes, sir?
This is a particularly fine specimen. Whose is it?
Well, it belongs to the Honourable Mr. Waldwick, sir.
Ah, then Mr. Waldwick is going to assist a beauty in distress. Yeah. Excuse
what?
Me.
Oh.
I think this might be the solution to your little problem.
Huh? Oh, thank you.
Good day.
There are a few things I ought to tell you about the young lady in the Bird of Paradise hat. In fact, it's all so complicated and so vital to the plot that I think you ought to note them down. Got a pencil and paper handy? Right, I'll begin. Her name is Eve Halliday. The more quick-witted among you will instantly remember that that is the name of the young lady who is coming down to catalogue the library at Blandings. But there is more to her than that. For one thing, Freddy Threepwood is hopelessly, and I use the word advisedly, in love with her. For another, she is the closest friend of Phyllis, the wife of Mike Jackson, who is the closest friend of Smith. And Phyllis, you will remember, is the stepdaughter of Lady Constance's husband, Joe Keeble. Eve is determined to persuade Keeble to change his mind. Got all that? Right.
Indeed. Asking about his umbrella, eh?
Made a great fuss about it, he did.
And rightly. The good man loves his umbrella.
Of course I had to tell him that you took it, sir.
I would not have had it otherwise. I like this spirit of candour. There must be no subterfuge between you and Comrade Waldwick. Let all be open and above board.
He seemed very put out, sir. He went off to find you.
I'm always glad of a chat with Comrade Waldwick. Always.
I think this is him coming now, sir.
I mustn't waste the day in idle chatter. Gather ye rosebuds and all that. I must find a cab.
Cab! Hi! Smith! Oh, dear! Oh, dash it!
Ah, Comrade Waldwick, what have we on our mind?
You don't mind if I get in my cab, do you? It's raining. Where's my umbrella? Where's my umbrella?
Don't shout, Comrade Waldwick.
Wig says you took my umbrella. I mean, a joke, but that was a dash good umbrella.
It was indeed. I selected it as the only possible one from a number of competitors. I fear the club is becoming very mixed, Comrade Waldwick. You would hardly believe the rottenness of some of the umbrellas I inspected in the cloakroom.
Where is it?
The cloakroom? Well, you turn to the left as you go in the main entrance.
Oh, my umbrella, dash it. I'm getting wet. Oh, where is it?
Ah, there you have me. I gave it to a young lady in the street. Where it is at the present moment, I could not say.
You gave my umbrella to a girl, but I'm getting soaked.
Be brave, Comrade Waldwick. Face the thing like a man. I shall be vastly surprised if you do not go down in legend and song. Children in ages to come will cluster about their grandfather's knees saying, tell us how the great Waldwick lost his umbrella, Grandpapa. And he will tell them, and they will rise from the recital better, deeper, broader children.
No!
Oh, and I fear I'm keeping you standing in the rain. I really must conclude our little chat. A cabby, the morning cloak, please.
Yes, just what we needed.
What's that?
Yeah, the rain. Just what we needed. I'll give my begonias up for lost.
Box 365.
Mind you, if it carries on like this, oh, they'll be belted to shreds.
Quite.
Oh, here are, sir, 7 letters.
Ah, thanks.
Take a seat over there, sir. Read them in comfort.
Thank you. There are 3 letters from philanthropic Scotsmen offering to advance me money. 1 bookie, 1 undertaker. This night shall thy soul be required of thee. Who gave you wibbly-wob for the Jubilee Cup? Oh, this looks more like it. If R. Smith will meet the writer in the lobby of the Piccadilly Hotel at 12 sharp Friday, July the 1st, business may result if business meant and terms reasonable. R. Smith will wear a pink chrysanthemum in his buttonhole and will say to the writer, there will be rain in Northumberland tomorrow, to which the writer will reply, good for the crops. Kindly be punctual. Well, at least it'll while away the weary hour before lunch. Just time to buy a chrysanthemum. There will be rain in Northumberland tomorrow.
My dear old chap, I've been waiting for you to speak for the last 5 minutes. Knew we'd met before somewhere, but couldn't place you. Fancy meeting you again like this.
It's a small world.
I'd ask you to come and have a drink. But the fact is, my ass of a man sent me out this morning without a penny. Forgot to give me my note case.
How trying.
I'll tell you what. Lend me a fiver, my dear old boy. That's the best way out of the difficulty. I can send it round to your hotel or wherever you are this evening when I get home.
Leave me, comrade.
Eh?
Pass along, old friend, pass along.
Nothing doing?
Nothing.
No harm in trying.
None whatever.
You look such a perfect monk with that eyeglass. It quite tempts a chap.
I can quite understand how it must.
No offence, then. No offence.
The situation is somewhat losing its sparkle. A chappy in a snuff-coloured suit. Huh? Here goes. There will be rain in Northumberland tomorrow.
Eh?
There will be rain in Northumberland tomorrow.
Sorry, I didn't quite catch...
There will be rain in Northumberland tomorrow.
No, my name's Prescott.
I say, did I hear you say that there would be rain in Northumberland tomorrow?
If you were anything within the radius of 12 yards while I was chatting with that deaf adder, I think it's possible that you did.
Good for the crot. Come over here where we can talk quietly. So you're Harper Smith.
The same.
I say, Dashit, you're frightfully late, you know. I told you to be here at 12 sharp. It's nearly 12 past.
You wrong me. I arrived here precisely at 12, since when I have been standing like patience on a monument.
Like what?
Let it go. It is not important.
And I asked you to wear a pink chrysanthemum.
I am wearing a pink chrysanthemum. I should have imagined that was a fact that could hardly be overlooked.
With that thing, I thought it was some kind of cabbage. I meant one of those little, what do we call it, that people do wear in their buttonholes.
Carnation, possibly?
Yeah, that's right.
If you had studied botany at school, comrade, much misery might have been avoided. I cannot tell you the spiritual agony I suffered trailing through the metropolis behind this shrub.
Good Lord, I've only got about 5 minutes. My governor insisted I caught the 12:50 back. Didn't want me hanging around in town and all that. I told him I had to go to my dentist. There'll be the deuce lot of unpleasantness if I miss that train. Now, I've got to talk quick about this thing. Do you know, you aren't in the least like what I expected you to be.
In what respect do I fall short of the ideal?
Well, it isn't so much falling short. I thought you'd be a tougher specimen altogether. I got the impression from your advertisement that you were down and out and ready for anything, and you look as if you were on your way to a garden party at Buckingham Palace.
Ah, it is my costume that's causing these doubts in your mind. Have no misgivings. These trousers may sit well, but if they do, it is because their pockets are empty. My uncle installed me in a highly lucrative life of toil in Billingsgate, but I have thrown it over to face the perils of the world outside. To be professionally connected with a firm that handles fish in the raw...
Hey, I say, old thing, you couldn't talk a bit less, could you? I've only got about 2 minutes.
I beg your pardon. Proceed.
Look here. You said in your advertisement that you had no objection to crime.
Within reason. And if undetected.
Well, look here. Will you steal my aunt's diamond necklace?
Steal your aunt's necklace?
Yes.
You do not think she might consider it a liberty from one to whom she has never been introduced?
Well, look here, is it... Good Lord, I must go. I shall miss that damn train.
And meanwhile?
Write and tell me what you think about it.
You have unfortunately omitted to leave an address.
I'll write to you.
I shall count the minutes. Oh, after all that excitement, a quiet lunch would not come amiss. The senior conservative is called for, I fancy.
Oh, I've just remembered another thing I meant to tell you about Eve Halliday. One of her closest schoolgirl chums was a girl called Cynthia. And this Cynthia married Ralston MacTodd, the Canadian poet who Lady Constance had invited to Blandings. Sorry about that. Oh, I ought to point out that this is proving to be a singularly trying day for MacTodd. He has walked out on Cynthia forever, leaving her in floods of tears in the Cadogan Hotel, and Lord Emsworth has just walked out on him, leaving him to meditate upon the restrained splendours of the Senior Conservative Club.
I say, is this chair occupied?
No, it isn't.
You would not be perturbed if I were to take it?
You can take it away and burn it, for all I care.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but do I seem to detect in your manner a certain half-veiled annoyance? Is anything the matter?
Oh, no. Nothing's the matter. Nothing whatever. I was invited out to lunch here by an old idiot who calls himself Lord Emsworth. To begin with, he's lost his glasses and can't see a thing. Lurches into every table in the place and just stands around burbling apologies. Well, then, when we do eventually get down to lunch, he goes on and on about his infernal hollyhocks and his stupid gardener. Never lets me get in a word edgeways. We come here for coffee. He doesn't even have the common civility to offer me a cigar.
Very lamentable.
And then some guy comes in bringing the old idiot spectacles. Claps them on his face. Do you know what he does?
For once, the imagination is baffled.
He sees that flower shop out there through the window. And he rushes out, buries himself in there without a word of apology, leaving me sitting here. I've never been so insulted in my life.
Scarcely the perfect host.
If he thinks I'm going to go down with him this evening and stay at his castle after this, he's mistaken. I'm going away now, this very minute. And if that old total loss ever comes back, you can tell him he's seen the last of me.
Coffee, sir? Thank you, yes. Thank you.
My dear MacTodd, I really must apologize.
Not at all. Not at all.
I was afraid for a moment that You might, quite naturally, be offended. Shouldn't have left you like that. Shocking bad manners, but I simply had to pop into that flower shop. Beautiful roses that man has. Beautiful. Extraordinary fine display.
Indeed.
Nothing to touch mine, though. I wish you could have been down at Blandings at the beginning of the month. My roses were at their best then. Still, I shall have plenty of flowers to show you in the morning.
Will you?
Expect you'll write one of your poems about the gardens at Blandings.
Very possibly. Very possibly.
Lord Emsworth.
Aye. What?
A lady to see your lordship.
A lady?
A Miss Halliday.
Oh. Miss Halliday? Oh, yes, of course, yes. She's coming down to Blandings to catalogue the library. If you'll excuse me for a moment, my dear fellow.
And now I fear it is time to take up my hat and silently steal away. I suppose it may cause the old boy a bit of a pang when he finds he's a poet short, but what is that in these modern days when poets are so plentiful? But how am I going to get past him? He's on the steps talking to... It's her. The girl in the Bird of Paradise hat. She must be Miss Halliday. And she's going to Blandings.
Ah, my dear fellow, must you be off? Don't forget our train leaves Paddington at 5 sharp.
At 5 sharp, I shall be there.
Capital, my dear fellow.
Does Miss Halliday travel with us?
No. She's coming down in a day or two.
I shall look forward to meeting her.
It may surprise you the ease with which Smith has taken upon himself the guise of MacTodd. But you must understand that Blandings thrives on impostors. It's a kind of cottage industry. The castle has been known to shelter 2 or 3 of them at the same time, even pretending to be the same person. Very little of this ever impinges very deeply upon the mind of the Ninth Earl.
It'll be dark, I suppose, by the time we arrive, but the first thing tomorrow, my dear fellow, I must take you round and show you my gardens.
I shall look forward to it keenly. They are, I should imagine, distinctly Ujarcum Smith.
I beg your pardon. What did you say?
I was saying that from all reports, you must have a pretty nifty display of garden produce at your rural seat.
Oh, yes. Oh, most. Most extraordinary. I trust, my dear fellow, you'll not think me personal, but, you know, nobody would imagine that you were a poet. You don't look like a poet. Dash it, you don't talk like a poet.
Well, how should a poet talk?
Oh, well, like Miss Peavy. She waylaid me the other morning when I was having a most important conference with MacAllister on the subject of bulbs, and asked me if I didn't think it was fairies' teardrops made the dew.
Oh, evidently an aggravated case. Is Miss Peavy staying at the castle?
Oh, my dear fellow, you couldn't shift her with blasting powder. Really, the craze of my sister Constance for filling the house with these infernal literary people. It's getting on my nerves. Take you, for instance. Never set eyes on you in her life. But the moment she heard you were in England, she couldn't rest till she had got you down.
I see.
Of course, it's all right, as it's turned out. As I say, you're different, but how you came to write that...
Bilge?
The very word I was about to employ, my dear fellow. I mean, capital stuff, no doubt, capital stuff, but...
I understand.
Fact is, good Lord, Frederick. Frederick!
Oh, I say, Governor!
I thought I told you to be sure to return on the 12:50 train.
Missed it, Governor. Not my fault.
This is my son, Frederick. Frederick, this is Mr. MacTodd, the poet. Coming to stay at Blandings. Well, I'm going to the restaurant car for a cup of tea. Will you join me, Mr. MacTodd?
I would prefer, if you do not mind, to remain here for a moment and foster what I feel sure is about to develop into a great and lasting friendship. I'm convinced that your son and I have much to talk about together.
Oh, very well, my dear fellow. As you wish.
I say, what?
If there's anything that I can do to clear up any little difficulty that's perplexing you, call on me. What's biting you?
I say, he said your name was McTodd.
Precisely.
But you said it was Smith.
It is.
Then why did Father call you McTodd?
A case of mistaken identity, I fear. He seemed to need a McTodd, and who was I to deny him the pleasure?
Do you mean to say that you're coming down to Blandings pretending to be this poet blighter?
That is the scheme.
But why?
I have my reasons, Comrade Threepwood. You'll pardon me if I don't go into them. And now, to resume our very interesting chat, which was unfortunately cut short this morning, why do you want me to steal your aunt's necklace?
Well, look here. I might as well start at the beginning.
An excellent idea.
You see, it's like this. My uncle, old Joe Keeble.
Keeble? Why is that name familiar?
But don't interrupt, old lad.
Yeah, I stand corrected.
Uncle Joe had a stepdaughter, Phyllis her name is, and some time ago she popped off and married a cove named James.
The proceeds, then, of this jewel robbery, if it comes off, will go to establish the Jackson home on a firm footing. Am I right in thinking that?
Absolutely. Uncle Joe's giving me, giving me a bit for myself, you understand.
Can't think of a better course. My dear Comrade Threepwood, you can rely on my cooperation.
You'll do it.
I will.
Of course, I'll see that you get a bit all right.
Dear Comrade Threepwood, let us not become sordid on this glad occasion. As far as I'm concerned, there will be no charge.
What?
But it's true that I am not a man of affluence. My bank manager, I'm told, winces in a rather painful manner whenever my name is mentioned. But I'm not so reduced that I must charge a fee for performing a simple act of courtesy, like pinching a £20,000 necklace on behalf of a man who was my boyhood chum.
Good Lord, fancy that.
And now, Comrade Threepwood, I must ask you to excuse me while I get the half-Nelson on this rather poisonous poetry of good old McTodd's. I spent a portion of my slender capital on his works in order not to be taken at a disadvantage. From a brief perusal in the cab, I think the fellow's not compass. They're certainly not light summer reading. Across the pale parabola of joy.
What's that?
There you have it, Comrade Threepwood. What is it? Across the pale parabola of joy.
And now, my dear McTodd, I'll show you the Empress of Blanding. Beach. How is the Empress?
Feeding, my lord.
Splendid, splendid. Come along, McTodd.
You will find her ladyship and Miss Peavy in the arbour by the bowling green, your lordship.
Oh, really? Righto. Come along. She's been feeding well, you know. Likes her mash.
Her mash?
Yes, yes. Problem is getting the ingredients right in a bran mash, you know.
How do you do, Mr. McTodd? I'm so glad you were able to come, after all.
After all? How kind of you to say so.
We're quite a small party at present, but we're expecting a number of people quite soon for the county ball. For the moment, Aileen and you are our only guests. Oh, I am sorry. I should have... Miss Peavy, Mr. McTodd.
Maître.
I beg your pardon?
Master. How wonderful that you were able to come, after all.
After all?
You know Miss Peavy's work, of course.
Who does not?
Maître, you do? I scarcely hope that you would know my name. My Canadian sales have not been large.
Quite large enough.
Oh?
I mean, of course, that while your delicate art may not have a universal appeal in a young country, it is intensely appreciated by a small and select body of the intelligentsia.
Oh, Mr. McTodd, you can hardly appreciate how I feel meeting you. It is like the realization of some golden dream. It is like...
I think I'll just pop off for a whiskey and soda.
Yeah, I'm going to have a look at my flowers.
Don't be silly, Clarence. It's much too dark to see flowers.
I can smell them.
Lady Constance, I wonder if I might...
Ah, Baxter, my dear fellow. Here we are. You see... I'm just going.
Mr. Baxter, I want you to meet Mr. McTodd.
Mr. McTodd?
Yes, he found himself able to come after all.
Ah.
Maître, could I persuade you to write some little thought in my autograph book and sign it? I have a fountain pen.
I'll put the light on.
Just some little thought.
There. May I look?
Across the pale parabola of joy. How strange to think that you should have chosen that line There are several of your more mystic passages that I meant to ask you to explain, but particularly across the pale parabola of joy.
You find it difficult to understand?
A little, I confess.
Well, perhaps I did put a bit of topspin on that one.
I beg your pardon?
I say perhaps it is a little obscure. We must have a long chat about it later on. Why not now? I'm rather tired after the journey. We artists...
Of course. Shall we find Lord Emsworth, Mr. McTodd? Flowers are very beautiful by night.
Oh, indeed, yes. When I'm surrounded by flowers, a sort of divine peace floods over me. I sometimes think, Miss Peavy, that flowers must be the souls of little children who died in their innocence.
What a beautiful thought, Mr. McTodd.
Yes. Don't finish it, it's copyright.
Charming, is he not?
I beg your pardon?
I said I thought Mr. McTodd was charming.
Oh, quite.
I'm so glad he was able to come after all. That telegram he sent us this afternoon seemed so curt and final.
So I thought it.
Almost as if he'd taken offence at something and decided to have nothing to do with us.
Quite.
Good night, Baxter.
Constance, my dear, I should have coffee. Why have I none?
I'm sure I gave you some.
Well, then where is it?
Your coffee is behind the seed catalogue you're reading, Lord Emsworth. You propped the catalogue against your cup.
Did I? Oh, why, so I did. Bless my soul.
I've had a letter from Miss Halliday. She's catching the 12:50 train at Paddington, which means that she should arrive at Market Blandings at almost 3.
Who is Miss Halliday?
The exact question I was about to ask myself. Baxter, my dear fellow. Who exactly is Miss Halliday?
Halliday is a very old and valued friend of mine.
Oh. What?
We too have, so to speak, pulled the gowns fine.
Oh, I say.
Friend of yours? Well, you better go down and meet her, my dear fellow. At the station, you know. Be glad to see you.
I was about to suggest it myself.
Oh, capital. Well, who she is and what she's doing here, goodness only knows.
And now, I'm going to have a look at the lobelias. I have always held that there's no finer tonic than a good look at a lobelia immediately after breakfast. Doctors, I believe, recommend it.
I say, can I have a couple of words with you a bit later on?
1,000, if you wish it. You will find me somewhere out there in the great open spaces where men are men.
I'm getting jumpy as a cat. I believe that blighter Baxter suspects something about you.
What do you think he suspects?
I mean... it's the way he looks at you. I don't like it.
Well, nor from the aesthetic point of view do I.
But we must bear these things manfully. We must remind ourselves that it is Baxter's misfortune rather than his fault that he looks like a dyspeptic lizard.
And it isn't only Baxter. The whole atmosphere of the place is getting rummy. I say, I believe the new housemaid is a detective.
What new housemaid?
Susan, her name is. Did you ever see a real housemaid sweep under a bureau?
Does she?
Caught her at it in my room this morning.
Hmm. Isn't it a trifle far-fetched to imagine that she's a detective?
Well, I've seen such a dash lot of films where the housemaid or whatnot's a detective. Makes a fellow uneasy.
Oh, fortunately, there's no necessity to remain in a state of doubt. I can give you an unfailing method by means of which you can discover what she is.
What's that?
Kiss her.
Kiss her?
Precisely. Go to her and say, Susan, you're a very pretty girl.
But she isn't.
We will assume for purposes of argument that she is. Go to her and say, Susan, you're a very pretty girl. What would you say if I were to kiss you? If she's a detective, she will reply, how dare you, sir? Whereas if she is the genuine housemaid I believe her to be, she will giggle and remark, oh, don't be silly, sir.
I'll think it over. I say...
You have my ear, Comrade Threepwood.
I say, what I really came out here to talk to you about was something else. I say... are you really a pal of Miss Halliday's?
Assuredly. Why?
I say, I wish you would put in a word for me, what?
Put in a word for you?
I love her, dash it. I've been in love with her for months. But she won't take me seriously and all that. Laughs at me, don't you know, when I propose. What would you do?
I should stop proposing.
But I can't.
Just say to yourself, from now on, I will not start proposing until after lunch. That done, it will be an easy step to do no proposing during the afternoon. And by degrees, you'll find that you can give it up altogether. Once you've conquered the impulse for the after-breakfast proposal, the rest will be easy.
Yes, but I say, will you?
Will I what?
Put in a word for me.
If the subject crops up in the course of the chit-chat, I shall be delighted to spread myself with no little vim on the subject of your fine qualities. Welcome to our village.
What are you doing here?
Oh, Lord Emsworth was kind enough to suggest that as we were old friends, I should come down in the car and meet you.
Are we old friends?
Have you so soon forgotten our deathless encounter beneath the awning of Thorpe and Brisker?
Are you staying at the castle?
Yes. And what is more, I'm the life and soul of the party. You'll find the car outside if you care to go and sit in it. I'll take care of your luggage.
I'm very glad you're here. Because, as a matter of fact, I'm feeling just the least bit nervous.
Nervous? Why?
This is my first visit to a place of this size. Is everything very stately?
Not at all. We are very homely folk, we of Blandings Castle. We go about, simple and unaffected, dropping gracious words all over the place. Lord Emsworth didn't overawe you, did he?
Oh, he's a dear. And, of course, I know Freddy quite well.
Ah.
Have you known Lord Emsworth long?
I met him for the first time the day you did.
Good gracious. And he invited you to the castle?
Strange, I agree. One can only account for it, can one not, by supposing that I radiate some extraordinary attraction. Have you noticed it?
No.
No? Oh, well. No doubt it will flash upon you quite unexpectedly sooner or later. Like a thunderbolt or something.
I think you're greatly conceited.
Not at all. Conceited?
Oh, no. Success has not spoiled me.
Have you had any success?
None whatever. We get down here.
Here? Why?
Because if we go up to the house, you will infallibly be pounced on and set to work by Baxter. Delightful fellow, but a whale for toil. I propose to conduct you on a tour around the grounds, and then we'll go for a row on the lake. You'll enjoy that.
You seem to have mapped out my future for me.
I have.
I'm afraid I haven't time to wander about the grounds. I must be going to see Mr. Baxter.
Baxter is not one of the beauties of the place. Time enough to see him when you're compelled to. We are now in the southern pleasaunce, or the west home park, or something. Note the refined way the deer are cropping the grass.
I haven't time.
We proceed to the northern Meswits. The dandelions were imported from Egypt by the 9th Earl.
Well, anyway, I won't come to the lake.
You will enjoy the lake. The newts are of the famous old Blanding strain. They were introduced, together with the water beetles, in the reign of Queen Elizabeth. Lord Emsworth, of course, holds manorial rights over the mosquito swatting. Before us now lies the celebrated Yew Alley. Speaking in my capacity of guide to the estate, I may say that when we have turned the next corner, you will see a most remarkable sight.
What would you do if I were to kiss you?
How dare you! Don't be so silly, sir.
Just a little kiss. Oh, I say...
I think it would be discreet if we were to withdraw in the direction of the house. Painful scene. But we must always strive to be charitable. He may have been taking a fly out of her eye or teaching her jiu-jitsu. You seem less revolted than one might have expected. Mark you, I don't think that this sort of thing is a hobby of Comrade Threepwood's. He probably has many other ways of passing his spare time. Remember that before you pass judgment on him.
I haven't any intention of passing judgment on him. It doesn't interest me what Mr. Threepwood does, either in his spare time or out of it.
His interest in you, on the other hand, is vast. I forgot to tell you before, but he loves you. Well, he asked me to mention it if the conversation happened to veer around in that direction.
I know he does.
And does the fact strike no chord in you?
I think he's a nuisance.
Very well. We will discard the topic of Freddy.
and I will try to find others that will elevate and amuse you. We are now approaching the main building.
I am going to report to Mr. Baxter. It's too absurd. I mustn't spend my time strolling about the grounds. I must see Mr. Baxter at once.
Nothing easier. The big open window there is the library. Doubtless Comrade Baxter is somewhere inside, toiling away among the archives.
But I can't announce myself by shouting at him.
Oh, assuredly not. Oh, no need for that at all. Leave it to me. One medium-sized flower pot should do the trick. Here we go. Oh! He is in. I thought he would be. Here he is. Ah, Baxter. Pleasant sunny afternoon.
Was it you?
You look like the blessed damosel gazing down from the bar of heaven. Baxter, I want to introduce you to Miss Halliday. You will like her. If I had a library, I could not wish for a more courteous, obliging and capable catalogist.
You
will no doubt wish on some future occasion to have a nice long chat with Miss Halliday in order to give her an outline of her duties. I have been showing her the grounds and am about to take her for a row on the lake.
Did you throw that flower pot?
You will find Miss Halliday a willing assistant, a tireless worker.
Did you?
But now I must be tearing myself away. A change into pale flannel is indicated for our row upon the lake. I shall only be a few minutes. Would you mind meeting me at the boathouse?
I am not going
on the
lake.
At the boathouse in, say, 6 1/4 minutes.
Ah, there you are, Miss, dear me, I've really forgotten your name. My memory is excellent as a rule. Miss Halliday. Of course. Baxter, my dear fellow, this is Miss Halliday.
Mr. McTodd has already introduced me to Miss Halliday.
Has he? Well, dash of love him. Where is he?
He went into the house after throwing a flower pot at me.
Right, doing what?
He threw a flower pot at me.
Why did Baxter throw a flower pot at McTodd? And where did he get it? No flower pots in the library.
Did you say his name was McTodd, Lord Emsworth?
Yeah, no. Baxter. That was my secretary.
No, I mean the one who met me at the station.
Baxter did not meet you at the station. The man who met you at the station was McTodd. He's staying here. And I strongly object to Baxter throwing flower pots at my guest.
Is Mr. McTodd a poet?
No. Yes. Oh, yes. There seems no doubt about that. Canadian poet. Apparently have poets out there, and why not? A remarkably growing country. Now, if you'll excuse me, I must be leaving. You know, I have to see my head gardener, MacAllister. Scotsman, obstinate man. If you go into the house, my sister Constance will give you tea. I don't know what the time is, but I suppose there will be tea.
Mr. McTodd asked me to go for a row on the lake.
Yeah, on the lake, eh? On the lake? Oh, of course. Yes, the lake. I think you'll like the lake.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but you appear to be brooding about something. What's the matter?
I have only just found out your name, Mr. McTodd. It was a great shock to me.
Well, I wouldn't call it a bad name, as names go. Don't you think there's a sort of Highland strength about it? Young Laird McTodd.
I ought to tell you, Mr. McTodd, that I was at school with Cynthia.
Indeed. With Cynthia. Well, that must have been jolly.
Oh, don't speak in that flippant, sneering tone. It's so cheap. After all, however you may feel about her now, you must have been fond of poor Cynthia at one time, or I don't see why you should have married her.
Sorry. Oh, how clumsy.
Oh, never mind about that. It doesn't matter. Mr. McTodd, I do wish you would tell me what the trouble was. I suppose you're thinking that this is no business of mine.
No, not at all.
You see, I'm devoted to Cynthia, and I like you. The friend who told me about you and Cynthia made it seem that the whole fault had been yours. I thought you must be a brute. But you've been so nice to me. Perhaps there is something I can do to help. Try to bring you together, you know.
That would, I fear, be impossible. It is like you to suggest it, but it is too late for any reconciliation. Cynthia and I are divorced.
Divorced? But how can you be divorced? It's only a few days since you and she were in London together.
I used the term in a spiritual rather than a legal sense. We are separated beyond hope of reunion. Love, Miss Halliday, is a delicate plant. It needs tending, nursing, assiduous fostering. This cannot be done by throwing the breakfast bacon at a husband's head.
What?
In the dish.
Cynthia did that?
On more than one occasion. Her temper in the mornings was horrible. I have known her lift the cat over two chairs in a settee with a single kick. And all because there were no mushrooms.
But I can't believe it.
Come over to Canada and I will show you the cat.
But she was always the gentlest little creature.
At school, you mean?
Yes.
That would, I suppose, be before she had taken to drink.
Taken to drink?
We lived in one of the dry provinces of Canada, and as so often happens, that started the trouble. From the moment she installed a private still, her downfall was swift.
Oh!
I hate speaking like this of one who was your friend, but I should not like you to think badly of me, Miss Halliday. I do not make friends easily. I'm a lonely man. But somehow it seemed to me since we met that we might be friends.
Why? Of course.
Thank you. Thank you. I have suffered. But if you will be my friend, I think that I may forget.
Enter. Comrade Threepwood. At any other time, Comrade Threepwood, certainly, but not now. I am not in the vein.
What?
At any other time, I should be delighted to listen to your farmyard imitations, but not now. I'm in a beautiful reverie and your presence jars.
Don't talk so much. Do you know what? You've jolly well got to get out of here quick. The game's up.
I fail to understand you, Comrade Threepwood.
I've just been talking to Baxter. He hauled me in as I was passing the library. He has seen through the whole damn thing practically from the moment you got here. Though he doesn't know that I've anything to do with it.
But how did our delightful friend happen to suspect that I was not all I seemed to be?
Well, in the first place, dash it, that damn fellow McTodd sent a telegram saying he wasn't coming.
Ah, that was what they all meant by saying they were glad I'd come after all.
Yeah, and then you went and wrote in the PV Female's autograph book. Baxter keeps every letter that comes into the place, and he'd kept McTodd's original answer, accepting the invitation to come here. He compared the handwriting with what you wrote in the Peavy's album, and of course they're not a damn bit alike.
Well, does he seem to have any idea why I've come to the castle?
Any idea? But why, dash it, the first thing he said to me was that you must have come to sneak Aunt Connie's necklace.
Well, in that case, why has he made no move until today?
He said he was pretty sure you wouldn't do anything on your own. He thought you'd wait until your accomplice arrived. And damn him, do you know who he's got the infernal gall to think is your accomplice? Miss Halliday, dash him. If I were you, I'd leg it today and have your luggage sent on after you.
Comrade Threepwood, you suggest a cowardly and weak-minded action. I think that with a little resource and ingenuity we may get through. Sad that these idyllic surroundings should have become oppressed with a cloud of sinister menace.
What?
What one fancied was the pipes of Pan turns out to be a police whistle.
Yes,
Still, we must bear these things without wincing. My purpose remains firm. The cry goes round the battlements. Smith intends to keep the old flag flying.
You remember what I told you about Blanding sheltering more than one impostor at a time beneath its ancient towers? I decided at this point that it was high time we had another.
Oh, hello there. Well, I didn't see you. It's quite dark in here after outside.
The light is pleasantly dim.
Is Lord Emsworth anywhere about?
I fear not. He has legged it, accompanied by the entire household, to superintend the unveiling of a memorial to, if my memory serves me rightly, the late Hartley Reddish Esquire, J.P., M.P. Is there anything I can do?
Well, I've come to stay, you know.
Indeed.
Lady Constance invited me to pay a visit as soon as I reached England.
Ah, then you have come from foreign parts.
Canada.
Really?
Yes. My name's McTodd. Ralston McTodd. I expect you have heard them speak of me.
You say that you are Ralston McTodd, the celebrated Canadian poet?
Yes, I do.
Then what is a pale parabola of joy?
What?
And here's another. The sibilant scented silence that shimmered where we sat. Could you oblige me with a diagram of that one?
What are you talking about?
It's lucky that you met me before you had to face the others. I fear that you undertook this little venture without thoroughly equipping yourself.
I don't know what you're talking about.
My dear comrade, I may as well tell you at once that the genuine McTodd is an old and dear friend of mine. I had a long and entertaining conversation with him only a few days ago.
Oh, hell. What are you going to do about it?
Nothing, comrade. By the way, what is your name?
Coots.
Nothing, comrade Coots. You're free to leg it hence whenever you feel disposed.
Say, that's darn good of you.
But before you go, tell me one or two things. I take it that your object in coming here was to have a pop at Lady Constance's necklace.
Well, yeah.
I thought as much. And what made you suppose that the real McTodd would not be here when you arrived?
Well, I travelled over with him on a boat. Saw a good deal of him when we got to London. I met him in the Strand, all worked up, madder than a hornet. Said he'd been invited down here, but wouldn't come if they begged him on their bended knees. He told me he was going straight off to Paris.
And, did he?
Well, I saw him off myself at Charing Cross. And that's why it seems such a cinch, me coming here instead of him. How was I to know that the first man I run into is a friend of his?
Now I think that perhaps it would be as well if you had a dash at the railway station. The household may be returning any moment now.
You're right.
You'll be happier when you're away from here. Once outside the castle precincts, a great weight will roll off your mind. A little fresh air will put the roses in your cheeks. You know your way, huh?
I'd rather taken a shine to Coots by this time. And it seemed rather a pity to let things fizzle out for him like that. So I thought I'd see what would happen if on the road back to Market Blandings he were to encounter Miss Peavy. This is going to come as quite a surprise to you, so stand by.
Liz!
Eddie! Can you tie it?
Well, if this isn't the cat's whiskers.
It's good to see you, Ed.
You don't still think I'm a pie-faced pug ugly?
Oh, did I say that?
You said I was so crooked I could hide behind a spiral staircase.
You had just cheated me out of $3,000.
Lizzie, you never gave me a chance to explain.
Okay. Forget and forgive, eh?
Liz, you're prettier than ever.
Now, you behave.
Smooth, Lizzie. What a partnership. You remember that night on the Atlantic Queen when we took that guy for 12 grand? You were just great. The best little decoy in the business. All my luck went after you. Hey, but let's not talk about my troubles. What are you doing here? Have you retired?
No, sir. I'm sitting in at a game with real worthwhile stakes. Diamonds, Eddie. A necklace. I've only had one look at it so far, but that was enough. Some of the best ice I've seen in years.
A necklace?
2 days out from New York, I made the biggest kind of hit with this Lady Constance Keeble.
What?
I'm visiting at a castle now.
Gee, if you fell down a well, Liz, you'd come up with a bucket. Do you know what I've been trying to do all afternoon? Only trying to edge into that damn place myself?
Oh, Ed! What was the stuff you pulled to get in?
Yeah, I thought I got it smooth.
Hold that!
There was this gink called McTarr, who said he'd been invited, but nobody ever set eyes on him.
You don't mean to tell me, Ed Coots, that you thought you'd get into the castle by pretending to be Ralston McTarr?
Why not? And the first guy I meet is a mutt who knows McTarr well.
So I beat it. I know when I'm not wanted.
But Ed, what do you mean? Ralston McTarr is at the castle now, this very moment.
How's that?
Sure, been there a couple of days. Long, thin bird with an eyeglass.
An eyeglass? But McTodd's not tall and thin, and he didn't wear no eyeglass. He's a fold of bunk games.
What?
And I let him shoo me out as if I was a stray pup.
What are you talking about?
And I thanked him. Thanked him?
Whatever are you...
The fellow with the eyeglass who told me he knew McTodd well must be the guy who's passing himself off as McTodd. He must have started working on the same lines as I did.
The big stiff. I had a feeling from the first that there was something not on the level about that guy. Gee, he must be after the necklace, too. What are you gonna do?
Do? I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. Say, what the hell am I gonna do?
Listen, this guy's ace high with Lady Constance. You've got to get him alone right away and tell him he's got to get you invited to the place as a friend of his.
But how am I to get him alone?
I can fix that. I'll ask him to come for a stroll with me. He's not exactly crazy about me, but he can't very well duck. You'll be in the bushes. I'll think of some excuse to send him back, and while I walk on, you jump out on him.
Liz,
You're the snake's eyebrows.
But what are you going to do if he turns you down?
See this? He won't turn me down.
Very well, Comrade Coots. You don't have to wave your little popgun about.
Don't you try any funny business.
I can assure you I contemplate no such thing. But since, as you so quaintly put it just now, you're on to my number, what do you propose to do about it?
You've got to get me into this joint.
I feared that was what you were about to suggest. In my particular position, I have naturally no choice but to endeavour to carry out your wishes. But how can I get you into what you breezily describe as this joint?
You can say I'm a friend of yours and ask them to invite me.
Not one of your brightest suggestions, Comrade Coots. Being myself merely a guest in this stately home of England, I can hardly go about inviting my chums here for indefinite visits. Now, we must find another way.
Someone's coming.
So there is. What instruments Providence puts into our hands?
What?
No matter. Beach?
Sir?
Who is that guy? Don't try any funny business.
Never fear.
Yes, sir.
Sorry to trouble you, Beach.
Not at all, sir.
This is my man. My valet, you know?
Ah.
He's just arrived from town. I had to leave him behind to attend the bedside of a sick aunt. Your aunt was better when you came away, Coot?
Yes, sir.
Capital, capital. Then you'll look after Coots, Beach?
Very good, sir. I will see to it straight away, sir.
I suppose you think that's pretty darn smart. But don't forget, I still got this.
Come in.
Sorry to intrude beyond the green baize, Beach. I just wanted to make sure that my man was settling in all right.
Oh, yes, sir, perfectly. I was not aware that you would be requiring his services until the dinner gong sounded, or I would have detained him. I was just...
Saluting the gracious evening mild?
Perhaps you'd care for a drop yourself, sir.
I would indeed. Thank you, Beach. There was another little matter I wanted to talk to you about.
Yes, sir.
I thought it might be as well to speak to you about it before approaching Lady Constance.
Of course, sir.
The fact is, I'm feeling cramped. Have you ever written poetry, Beach?
No, sir.
Ah. Then it may be a little difficult for you to understand my feelings. My trouble is this. Out in Canada, Beach, I grew accustomed to doing my work in the most solitary surroundings. I have got to get a place where I can be alone, Beach. A little cottage with honeysuckle over the door where I can turn the key and bid the world go by.
Oh, you desire a small cottage where you can write poetry, sir.
You follow me like a leopard. Do you know of such a one?
There is an unoccupied gamekeeper's cottage in the West Wood, sir. But it is an extremely humble place.
Be it never so humble, it will do for me. Do you think Lady Constance would be offended if I were to ask for the loan of it for a few days?
I fancy that her ladyship would receive the request with equanimity, sir.
I am much obliged to you for your sympathy and advice in this matter, Beach. I knew you would not fail me.
Not at all, sir.
Admirable. Admirable. Beach.
Mm-hmm.
Just one other thing. You might ask young Coots if he brought my revolver from town with him.
Yes, sir.
I think I saw it sticking out of his pocket. You might bring it to me, will you?
Very good, sir.
Top hole.
One of the little problems about keeping a complicated story like this going when you haven't got the plot thoroughly fixed in advance is that you do sometimes tend to lose sight of characters. Take Eve Halliday, for instance. She came down to Blandings determined to do something to help Phyllis, but thanks to Smith dominating the proceedings, so far she has done nothing about it.
Eve!
Well, Freddy?
Going anywhere?
Yes, I'm going down to Market Blandings to meet a friend. I must rush. Goodbye.
But I'll come with you.
No, I want to be alone.
But come with you as far as the gate. I do think you might marry a chap.
I suppose I shall someday, if I meet the right one.
No, I mean me.
Oh, Freddy.
I love you, dash it.
Well, stop loving me. I'm an awful girl, really. I'd make you miserable.
Oh, happiest man in the world.
It's absurd, Freddy. Really, it is. Apart from the fact that I don't want to marry you, how can you marry anyone? Anyone I mean, who hasn't plenty of money.
I wouldn't dream of marrying you for money.
What I meant was that you can't possibly marry a girl without money unless you've some money of your own.
I say, dash it, I say, is that really all that stands between us? Because
no, it
look,
isn't.
No, because look here. I'm going to have a good deal of money at any moment. Well, it's more or less of a secret, you know. In fact, a pretty deadish secret, so keep it dark. But Uncle Joe is going to give me a couple of £1,000.
Uncle Joe?
You know, old Keeble.
Mr. Keeble is going to give you £2,000? What for?
I don't know. He's just given it to me, don't you know?
Did you simply go to him and ask him for it?
Ooh, that's about the strength of it, yes. Well then, will you?
What?
But marry me.
Freddy, go away.
Eh?
I really don't want to talk any more. Will you be a dear and just go? I've got a lot of thinking to do.
Oh, thinking. Right-ho.
Thank you so much.
Not at all. Toulou?
All of which has filled Eve with the right combination of shame and determination. But how on earth is she to grab old Keeble round the throat when she is on her way down to Market Blandings to meet a friend whose identity I had better not reveal at this point? Well, Market Blandings houses the only reputable gents' hairdresser for miles around, from which Joe Keeble was just emerging, having had his grizzled locks clipped preparatory to the county ball.
Mr. Keeble?
Miss Hallenday, I beg your pardon, I was thinking.
Can you spare me a moment or two, Mr. Keeble? I want to talk to you about Phyllis.
Phyllis?
Your stepdaughter.
Do you know her?
She was my best friend at school. I had tea with her just before I came to the castle.
Extraordinary.
Of course, if you say it's none of my business...
My dear...
Well, it is my business, because she's my friend. Mr. Keeble, Phyllis told me that she had written to you about buying that farm. Why won't you help her?
Oh, I want to help her. I would do anything in the world to help her.
Then why don't you?
I'm curiously situated.
Yes? Phyllis told me something about that. But, Mr. Keeble, surely, if you can manage to give Freddie Threepwood £2,000...
He told you.
Yes, just now.
Gosh, you haven't told anyone.
Of course not.
You wouldn't tell anyone.
Why should I?
Of course, it isn't really stealing.
What?
I shall buy my wife another necklace.
You will what?
So that everything will be all right. Constance will be perfectly
Constance?
Happy. Don't you know?
No what?
Nothing. Forget what I was saying. I must be going.
Mr. Keeble, I don't know what you mean, but you were just going to say something which sounded... Mr. Keeble, do trust me. I'm Phyllis's best friend, and if you've thought of a way of helping her, I wish you would tell me. I might be able to help.
Well,
I think it's about time we summed up where we've got to. There are now four people after Lady Constance's necklace. Eve, who is acting for Joe Keeble. Smith, who is acting for Freddie, who is acting for Joe Keeble, and the well-known firm of Peavy and Coots, who are acting for themselves.
Where have you been all this darn time? Gosh dang it, you leave me a couple of days back saying you're going to make this bozo that calls himself McTodd get you into the house, and that's the last I see of you. What's the big idea?
It's all right, Liz. He did get me into the house. I'm his valet. That's why I couldn't get at you before.
Well, this is good, Ed. It couldn't have worked out better. I've got a scheme all worked out, and now you're here, we can get busy.
A scheme?
A pippin.
Spill it, Liz.
Well, to begin with, now that the house is packed full of gadzoonies who've come up for the county ball, her Nibs is wearing that necklace every night.
Where does she keep it, Liz? Have you found that out?
No, I haven't, and I don't want to. I've got no time to waste monkeying about with safes. I believe in getting things easy. Tonight, this bimbo that calls himself McTodd is going to give a reading of his poems in the big drawing room. You know where that is?
Well, I can find out.
And you better had find out. And before tonight at that. Because I'm going to sit behind Lady Constance while that goof is shouting his fool head off. And I'm going to reach out and grab that necklace off her, see?
But Liz, if you start any strong-arm work in front of everybody like the way you say, won't they...
No, they won't. Because when I do, it's going to be good and dark in that room. And it's going to be dark because you'll be somewhere out of the back of the house, wherever they keep the main electric light works, turning the switch as hard as you can go, see? I guess I can trust you not to bungle that.
Liz, you can trust me to do just that little thing. But all what right. are we going to...
I know what you're going to say. How do I get away with this stuff?
Yeah.
Well, the window'll be open, and I'll just get to it and fling the necklace out, see? And while everybody's cutting up and what the helling, you'll pick up your dogs, run round as quick as you can, and pinch the thing. Well, what do you think of it?
Liz, you're the oyster's eye tooth.
Across the pale parabola of joy. Ah, Miss Halliday. A pleasant night.
Yes.
The stars, bright, twinkling, and, if I may say so, rather neatly arranged. That wiggly thing up there is King Charles Wayne.
Yes?
Yeah, indeed. I assure you. I hear you went into Market Blandings this afternoon.
Yes.
Are you coming in to hear me read?
No.
You show your usual sterling good sense.
Shall I tell you why I went to Market Blandings this afternoon?
Do.
I went to meet Cynthia.
Oh, Cynthia.
Your wife.
Yes.
Directly after we had that talk on the lake, I wrote to Cynthia, telling her to come at once and meet me in Market Blandings at the Emsworth Arms.
Good beer.
What?
I said they sell good beer.
Never mind about the beer. I thought that if I could see her and have a talk with her, that you might become reconciled.
Oh, that was like you. That was an act worthy of your great heart. But I fear that the rift between Cynthia and myself...
I saw Cynthia, and she told me that her husband was in Paris.
How in the world did she get an idea like that?
The only excuse I can find for you is that you're mad. When I think of all you said to me about poor Cynthia on the lake that afternoon, when I think of all the sympathy I wasted on you...
Oh, not wasted. It made me love you, if possible, even more. Womanly intuition will have told you long ere this that I love you with a fervour with my poor vocabulary I cannot hope to express. True as you are about to say, we have known each other but a short time, as time is measured, but what of that?
After what has happened, I suppose I ought not to be surprised at finding you capable of anything. But are you really choosing this moment to propose to me?
To employ a favourite word of your own, yes.
And you expect me to take you seriously?
Assuredly not. I wish simply to go on record as an aspirant to your hand. Gradually, however, as the days go by and we are constantly together...
You surely aren't dreaming of staying on here now.
Well, most decidedly. Why not?
But what is to prevent me telling everyone that you are not McTodd?
Your sweet, generous nature. Your angelic forbearance. Considering that I came here as McTodd to be near you, I hardly think you will be able to bring yourself to get me slung out.
You are mad.
I have loved you since the moment when I saw you sheltering from the rain under that awning in Dover Street. I do not press for an answer
now. I should hope not.
I merely say, think it over. Reflect that I'm an acquired taste. You probably didn't like olives the first time you tasted them. Now you probably do. Give me the same chance you would an olive. All you have against me is the fact that I'm not Ralston McTodd. Well, think how comparatively few people are Ralston McTodd. Let your meditations proceed along these lines. I am not Ralston McTodd.
Everybody is waiting, Mr. McTodd.
Of course. Of course. I was forgetting. I'll get to work at once. You're quite sure you do not wish to hear a scuttle full of modern poetry, Miss Halliday?
Quite sure.
Well. Come, Comrade Baxter, let us be up and doing. I mustn't disappoint my public.
Well, I've been proposed to a fair number of times, but I've never had one like that before.
Across the pale parabola of joy, an urchin Pierrot treads his wheel, hurling a hyacinth scream of pain, where cobbled
well, at least life would never be dull.
Probing and,
he's certainly different.
Where the star's anguish batters...
And anyone who can recite drivel like that with such sublime confidence can't be all bad.
...their sharp essence on the screens of life. Sheltered staccatos shimmer through a sleeping palace in a window...
Ladies
and gentlemen, I think the light has gone out.
Oh, my dear.
What's going on? The diamond necklace. What shall I do? Hide it. The flower pot.
Curious, don't you think, the way that flower pots keep coming into the story? And don't think you've heard the last of them yet, not by any means. However, at this point in the plot, I had a problem. I've always thought of my characters in terms of actors in a play. If a well-known actor finds that all he's got is a short scene in Act One, he'll walk out. And that seemed to me just the case with Baxter. He had to have a good scene somewhere that would correspond to the latter part of Act Two. I decided to bring in one of those scenes of nocturnal confusion without which no stay at Blandings is ever complete. Baxter lies restlessly in bed. Susan, the chambermaid, she was a detective after all, has searched for the missing necklace without success. Baxter's alert brain melts the mists of sleep like snow in a furnace. I say, that's not bad, don't you think?
It's not in the girls' room or the valet's, which can only mean that it's hidden somewhere around the house. Like one of those stupid games they used to make me play when I was a child. What's that?
Now, it is part of the Blandings' tradition that no one prowls about in the middle of the night without colliding with something and knocking it over. In this case, Eve, creeping out in search of her precious flower pot, brought down a small table containing a vase, a jar of potpourri, an Indian sandalwood box of curious workmanship, and a cabinet-sized photograph of the Earl of Emsworth's eldest son, Lord Bosham.
Someone's prowling about downstairs. This will have to be investigated.
It is also a well-attested part of the Blandings' tradition that no one attempts to steal down the great staircase in the dark without...
No!
In this particular case, the cause of his downfall was a golf ball, left at the top of the stairs by Freddy Threepwood, who had been practicing putting in the corridor before retiring to bed.
The door's open. There's someone out there on the terrace. That's where they've hidden the necklace.
I should have pointed out that Baxter was wearing lemon-coloured pyjamas, a circumstance which made it all too easy for Eve to follow his movements as he began to explore the terrace and to race back to safety with her flower pot. With great presence of mind, she shut and bolted the door.
They've locked me out! Dratted bird!
I can't very well ring the bell. Not with all those bright young things assembled for the county ball. What ribald humour would they make out of my present costume? But there's no other way in. The castle was built to keep out invaders. And now it's keeping out me! Calm. Keep calm. Take advantage of the situation. Work out where they could have hidden the necklace. In the bushes. Too risky. In the hole of a tree? No. I know. They've hidden it in a...
Wait for it.
Flower pot. A whole row of them. If I wanted to hide a necklace where I could be sure of finding it again, that's exactly where I'd put it.
If there are any of you who are excessively sensitive about geraniums, I suggest you go and make yourselves a cup of tea. For Baxter is going to empty out every pot without giving so much as a single thought to the tender plants he is casting about the terrace.
Nothing! Nothing! Damn! Damn! Damn!
Damn the Todd, or whatever his name is. Damn his valet. Damn the Halliday woman!
Oh.
got to get back inside. No one will be out for hours. Must be some way I can wake them up. A pebble. That should do it. Not a whisper. I'll have to try something bigger.
I told her that we weren't through with flower pots, not by a long chalk. To me and to Baxter and to the whole waking dawn chorus around him, there seemed to be only one way to rouse the sleeping household. Say it with flower pots.
What's that? What? Must have been dreaming. Oh, flower pot. Oh, flower pot. I don't recollect bringing it to bed with me. Hot water bottle, yes. Flower pot. Why should I have done that? There's another. What can it mean? Who can be throwing? Why should I... Baxter. It must be Baxter. He was pitching flower pots at Mac Todd only the other day. It is Baxter. Those frightful pajamas. Yeah, Mac Todd. Mac Todd.
What is it?
Well, my dear fellow.
Oh, come in. Come in. Will you take a seat?
No, I'm extremely sorry to be obliged to wake you, my dear fellow, but the fact is my secretary Baxter's gone off his head.
Oh, much?
Yeah, he's out in the garden, in his pyjamas, throwing flower pots through my window.
Flower pots?
Yes, I was hoping that you might consent to go down, possibly having armed yourself with a good stout stick, and induce him to desist and return to his bed, aren't?
A sound suggestion in which I can find no flaw. I will see what can be done.
Lethargy had been creeping remorselessly over the efficient Baxter. Sleep, which he had been denying to himself for so long, could be denied no more.
Awake, awake, beloved, for morning and the bowl of night has flung the stone that puts the stars to flight.
Oh, you've been long enough. You!
And lo, the hunter of the east has caught the sultan's turret in a noose of light. You will find the sultan himself speculating idly on your motives for bunging flower pots at him. Why, if I may venture the question, did you?
Baxter? My dear fellow?
I can explain everything, Lord Emsworth.
What?
I can explain everything.
It turns out to be very simple. He was practicing for the jerking the geranium event at the next Olympic Games.
Baxter, my dear fellow, your face is dirty.
I was digging. I was digging.
What?
Digging!
Digging? What were you digging for?
I thought Lady Constance's necklace was in one of the flower pots.
What?
I can't stand it in all of it!
What did he say?
He said he thought that Lady Constance's necklace was in one of the flower pots.
Baxter thought my sister's necklace was in a flower pot?
So I understood him to say.
Why should my sister keep her necklace in a flower pot?
Ah, there you take me into deep waters.
The man's stark staring mad. I thought so before, now I'm convinced of it. I must get rid of him. Yes. I must get rid of him. Well, my dear fellow, I suppose we'd better be getting back to bed. Seeing if we can't get a little sleep, huh?
And now, let us survey our little band of conspirators on the morning after the crime. We have Joe Keeble, all serenity and breathing generosity.
You're not making much progress with that egg, Connie. And you haven't touched your toast. No appetite, eh? Connie, do you know what I'm going to do?
No, Joe. What are you going to do?
I'm going to telephone the jeweler I bought that old necklace from, and I'm going to ask him to make you another one, just the same in every detail, so that even you won't be able to tell the difference.
Joe!
No, Connie. Don't try to talk me out of it. My mind's made up.
Joe Keeble, you are magnificent. There's no other word for it. Not a word of reproach for me being so stubborn, so pig-headed. Oh, Joe.
That's better, Connie. Now, let's see you have another go at that egg.
Keeble's serenity and generosity were in for a severe jolt.
No, Uncle Joe, I never got near the bally thing.
But Eve, surely it was she who had escaped with the priceless flower pot.
Oh, Mr. Keeble, I had it. I had it in my own hands. I thought it would be safe to leave it inside the great hall. And now it's gone.
And there was little cause for abandoned jollity in the Peavy camp either.
But Liz, I'm telling you, I couldn't find the stuff.
You're the sort of dumb Isaac that couldn't find a bass drum in a telephone booth.
Somebody must have got there first and swiped it.
Who could have? Everyone was up in the room. Cheese it, Ed. There's someone coming.
Ah, fine morning, Miss Peavy. What must it feel to be a blackbird throwing up your heart in song? I'm taking Miss Halliday for a tour around the estate. She seems a little downcast.
I think we're all a bit upset after what happened last night. I was dreadfully frightened, weren't you, Miss Halliday?
I wasn't there.
But we mustn't ramble on like this. Who knows what train of poetic thought we may have interrupted. Come, Miss Halliday.
Ed! Ed! Did you hear? That girl. She said she wasn't in the drawing room when the lights went out. She was down on the terrace, that's where she was, picking up the stuff. And if it isn't in that shack of McTodd's down there in the woods, I'll eat my Sunday rubbers.
What a horrible-looking place. Whatever do you want it for?
Yes, there's no doubt that it wants doing up a bit, by a woman's gentle hand. Will you take a look round and give out a few ideas?
Well, I don't know where I...
You were saying? You're admiring the geranium. I found it lying about up at the castle this morning and pinched it. I'm bound to say I'm a little disappointed in the thing. I had a sort of idea it would turn the old homestead into a rural bower. It doesn't seem to.
It's... it's a beautiful geranium.
There, I cannot agree with you. It seems to have the glanders or something.
It only wants watering.
And unfortunately, this cosy little place appears to possess no water supply. If this moribund plant fancies that I'm going to spend my time racing to and fro with refreshments, it is vastly mistaken. Tomorrow, it goes in the dustbin.
Oh! What a shame. You'd better give it to me. I'll take care of it.
Well, pray, take it. And very encouraging it is that you should be accepting gifts from me in this hearty fashion. For it is well known that there's no surer sign of the dawning of the divine emotion love than this willingness to receive presents from the hands of the adorer. I make progress.
You don't do anything of the kind. I must be going. I've got work to do. There's nothing here. It's empty.
I had a terrible struggle with the ending. Everybody kept on telling me that I'd got it all wrong. After much agony of spirit, I finally kicked it into shape, I think. Well, see for yourselves. It's the night of the county ball, and the whole castle is in a frenzy of activity, like a barracks on the eve of a regiment's departure for abroad.
1, 2, 3, 4, dash it. Go. 1, 2, 3, 4,
it's ruined.
Don't be silly, darling. You look quite ravishing.
Oh, it's ghastly. It's so creased. I'm not going.
How do I look?
If I may say so, sir, the tie might be worth one more effort. Allow me, sir.
Ah, thank you. And see if you can rustle up a brandy and soda.
What a serious start. Afraid not, old chap. Lost mine yesterday. Had to strip down the Bugatti, you know.
Ah, good point. Are we taking your Bugatti or my Ferrari?
Ah, yes. Good question.
Hello. I say.
Well, Freddie.
Beastly shame you aren't coming to the hop.
I don't mind, but Freddie...
But I do, dash it. Thing won't be anything without you. Belly washout. And I've been trying some new steps out with the Victrola.
Listen, Freddie. I met Mr. Keeble yesterday, and he told me all about how you and he had planned to steal Lady Constance's necklace.
Good Lord.
It's all right. He asked me to steal the necklace, too.
You?
I just wanted to help Phyllis. She's my friend.
My gosh. Then it was you who got the thing last night.
Yes, but I haven't got it any longer. Is Mr. McTodd going to the ball?
Yes, I suppose so.
Then listen. As soon as everybody's gone, you and I are going round to that little cottage of his, and we're going to burgle it.
What?
Burgle it. He stole the jewels from me last night and hid them in the cottage.
But I say, I got him here to pinch the necklace for Uncle Joe.
What?
Absolutely. You see, I began to have a doubt or two as to whether I was capable of the contract, so I roped him in.
He's a friend of yours?
Well, I wouldn't say that exactly, but he said he was a great pal of Phyllis and her husband.
When did he tell you that?
In the train.
I mean, was it before or after you had told him why you wanted the necklace stolen?
Let me think. After.
Oh, Freddy. He obviously never heard of her in his life until you mentioned her. He wants that necklace for himself.
Gosh, do you think he does?
And he isn't going to get away with it. You and I are going to find that necklace if we have to pull the place down.
Rather muck the place up a bit. I'm covered in soot.
You shouldn't have pulled the bricks out of the chimney.
But how did I know it would all come down? And those dead bats. Well, the belly thing isn't here.
But this isn't the only room in the house.
I think he might have hidden the stuff upstairs.
Or in the cellar. Take your lamp and go and have a look.
To be absolutely honest, I'd much rather
what?
Not go into the belly cellar.
Why not?
Well, beetles. Always had a horror of beetles, ever since I was a child.
All right. I'll go down to the cellar. You go and look upstairs.
Well, I say, are you sure you don't mind?
Nothing but bare stone and coal dust. Freddy! Freddy? Have you found it?
Good evening.
Huh?
It's nice of you to look in. Won't you sit down? On the sofa, perhaps? Or would you prefer a brick?
Where is Mr. Threepwood?
Upstairs. I've put him in storage for a while. He's under the impression that if he stirs out, he will be shot.
Won't you please put that revolver down?
I will park it on the mantelpiece while we chat.
Mister, I can't call you McTodd. Will you please tell me your name?
Smith. The P is silent, as you...
Well, Mr. Smith, I imagine you understand why I'm here.
Well, I took it for granted that you'd come to fulfil your kindly promise of doing the place up a bit. Will you be wounded if I say frankly that I preferred it the way it was before? All this may be the last word in ultra-modern decoration, but honestly, don't you think you've rather overstressed the bizarre note? All this soot. These dead bats.
I have come to get the necklace.
Ah, the necklace.
And I'm going to get it, too.
There, if you will pardon me, I take issue with you. It is plain that in some way or another, Comrade Threepwood has enlisted your services. And I regret to inform you that he is engaged in what I can only call funny business.
Will you please explain yourself?
The facts are as follows. Our mutual friend, Mr. Keeble, has a stepdaughter who looks upon me
as... What is the use of trying to fool me like this? You had never heard of Phyllis until Freddy mentioned her.
Believe me...
I won't. Freddy got you down here to help him steal that necklace and give it to Mr. Keeble so that he could help Phyllis, and now you're trying to keep it for yourself.
Is everybody in on this little plot?
Mr. Keeble asked me to try to get the necklace for him.
Oh, this opens up a new line of thought. When I found Freddy here, I jumped to the conclusion that he was trying to double-cross myself and Uncle Joe. Never occurred to me that he might be crediting me with the same sinful guile.
Mr. Smith, are you really a friend of Phyllis?
She looks on me as a grandfather. Are you a friend of hers?
We were at school together. But I never heard her speak of you.
Strange. Was there some snobbish strain that kept her from admitting that she was accustomed to hobnob with one in the fish business?
Fish business? Fish? Smith? Of course I remember now. She said that Mike's best friend was in the fish business and that his name was Smith. She said you were just my sort of... She said she wanted me to meet you.
This is one of the most gratifying moments of my life. It seems to me that you and I were made for each other. I'm your best friend's best friend, and we both have a taste for stealing other people's jewellery. I cannot see how you can very well resist the temptation that we are twin souls.
Don't be silly. Where is the necklace?
The business note. Always the business note. Ah, well. You have heard of the acquisitive habits of the jackdaw, no doubt. There was a certain little chappie in Reeds.
The stuffed birds. The one place we didn't think of looking.
There.
Aren't they beautiful?
Distinctly. I think that I may say that of all the jewels I've ever stolen...
Hey! Stick 'em up.
Attaboy, Ed. I'll take the sparklers.
No funny business.
I would be the last person to advocate anything of the sort. Miss Halliday, this is Comrade Coots, of whom you've heard so much.
Miss Peavy!
Hello.
What I think Miss Halliday is trying to say is that she's finding it a little difficult to adjust her mind to the present development. I, too, must confess myself at something of a loss. I thought you were a poetess.
So I am a poetess. Just you start in joshing my poems and see how quick I'll bean you with a brick. Well, Ed, no sense in hanging around here. Let's go.
Okay, we'll have to tie these birds up. Otherwise, we'll have them squealing before we can make a getaway.
Ed, try to remember sometimes that that thing balanced on your collar is a head, not a Hubbard squash. How are they going to squeal? They can't say a thing without telling everyone they snatched the stuff first.
Hey, that's right.
Well, don't come butting in.
Pardon me, but if it's not a rude question, are you two married?
Huh?
You seem to talk to him like a wife. Am I addressing Mrs. Coots?
You will be if you stick around for a while.
A thousand congratulations to Comrade Coots. I'm thinking of getting married myself shortly and...
My foot's got this very ceiling!
Freddy!
What the...
Well done, Smith.
Ed! Ed!
I'll take that revolver, Comrade Coots. No funny business. Are you all right, Freddy?
Yes, I think so.
You think yourself smart, don't you?
I'm afraid that I must trouble you to hand over that necklace.
Try and get it. I'm going to walk straight out of here with this collection of ice right now, and I'll bet you won't have the nerve to start any shooting. Shoot a woman, not you.
Your trust in my sense of chivalry rests on solid ground, but I fancy I see a way out of the difficulty. I shall shoot not you, but Comrade Coots.
What?
I shall try to plug him in the leg, but I am a poor shot and I may hit him in some more vital spot.
Hey!
Give me that! No, get me!
Here, take it! Take it! Mr. Whatever your name is.
I thank you.
Well, that seems to be about all. Guess we'll be going. Come along, Ed. Pick up the Henrys.
I... Coming, Liz.
So that's it.
You have a happy gift of phrase. That, as you sensibly say, is that.
Fancy Miss Peavy being a thief.
I found myself warming to her. I almost wish that we'd not been compelled to deprive her of the jewels.
We? I'm afraid I didn't do much.
Your attitude was exactly right. You afforded just the moral support which a man needs in such a crisis.
So... you're going to be married?
I think so. I think so. What do you think?
Yes. I think so too. Shall I tell you something?
You could tell me nothing more wonderful than that.
When I met Cynthia in Market Blandings, she advised me, if I ever married, to marry someone eccentric. She said it was such fun. Well, I don't suppose I'm ever likely to meet anyone more eccentric than you, am I?
I think you would be unwise to wait on the chance.
You were wonderful just now. Simply wonderful. The way you made one spring...
Your words are music to my ears. But we must not forget that the foundations of the success of the manoeuvre were laid by Comrade Threepwood putting his foot through the ceiling.
Oh, good gracious! Oh, Freddy! Oh, I've forgotten all about him.
The right spirit, quite the right spirit.
We must go and let him out.
Just as you say. And then he can come with us on the stroll I was about to propose that we should take through the woods. It's a lovely night. And what could be jollier than to have Comrade Threepwood prattling at your side? I'll go and let him out at once.
No. Don't bother.
The importance of balancing the ingredients in a bran mash cannot be exaggerated. Always measure exactly, never...
Clarence, I want a word with you.
Connie, McAllister's waiting for me in the yew alley. I'm already late.
I shall not take up much of your time, Clarence. I wish to talk to you about Baxter.
Baxter? Too late to talk about Baxter. I've sacked him.
I think you must be mad.
Baxter's the one who's mad. He threw...
You're too absurd.
He threw flower pots at
me. Do please stop talking about those flower pots. Mr. Baxter has explained the whole thing to me, and surely even you must see that his behaviour was perfectly excusable.
I don't like the fellow.
You will be helpless without him.
Nothing of the kind.
You know you will. Where will you ever get another secretary capable of looking after everything like Mr. Baxter? You know you are a perfect child. And unless you have someone whom you can trust to manage your affairs, I cannot see what will happen. Chaos!
I have come to say goodbye, Lady Constance. Yeah. The car which is taking me to the station is at the door.
Oh, Mr. Baxter.
Goodbye, Lord Emsworth.
Eh? What? Oh, yes, yes. Goodbye, my dear fellow. I mean, goodbye. I hope you have a pleasant journey.
Thank you.
But Mr. Baxter...
Lord Emsworth, I am no longer in your employment.
But Mr. Baxter, surely even now... We can still talk over this little misunderstanding.
Yeah, I say.
I fear it is too late to talk things over.
There, you see.
Ever since I came to work for Lord Emsworth, my former employer, an American millionaire named Jevons, has been making me flattering offers to return to him. Until now, a mistaken sense of loyalty has kept me from accepting these offers. But this morning I telephoned to Mr. Jevons to say that I was at liberty and could join him at once. It is too late now to cancel that promise.
Oh, quite, quite. No, certainly, quite, quite. Oh, mustn't dream of it, my dear fellow. No. Oh, no, 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 indeed.
Then there is nothing more to say. I do not know what Blandings will be without you, Mr. Baxter. Goodbye.
And now, Mr. Baxter, if you'll excuse me, I will not
detain you long, Lord Emsworth.
Oh, my dear fellow, don't bother to...
I am no longer in your employment, but I think it is my duty to say before I go...
No, my dear fellow, I quite understand. I know what you're going to say, the matter of the flower pots. And please do not apologize, quite all right. I was startled at the time, I own, but no doubt you had excellent motive.
I had no intention of referring to the matter to which you allude. I only wish...
Yes, of course, yes. Some other time. Yes, that'll be capital.
Very well. Pray do not let me keep you. If you are not interested in the fact that Blandings Castle is sheltering a criminal...
Sheltering a criminal?
I must go now or I will miss my train. I was merely going to tell you that this fellow who calls himself McTodd is not Ralston McTodd at all.
Not Ralston McTodd? But he said he was.
He is an impostor. And I imagine that if you investigate, you will find that he and his accomplices stole Lady Constance's necklace.
But, my dear fellow...
You need not take my word for it. Compare the man's writing with the signature the real McTodd wrote when he accepted Lady Constance's invitation. You will find it filed in a corner of the desk there. Oh. Now that I am no longer in your employment, the thing does not concern me. But I thought you might be glad to hear the facts.
I am. Yes.
Goodbye.
Yes. But Baxter, my dear fellow. What on earth am I supposed to do? I can't very well have the fellow arrested. So deucedly unfriendly.
Good morning. I was looking for Miss Halliday.
My dear fellow, I
thought you might be in her little room yonder.
No.
I'm surprised to find you indoors on so glorious a morning.
My dear fellow, that's to say...
you were observing?
Baxter. Baxter has just departed from me.
Forever?
Yes.
Splendid, splendid.
The fact is, he made, before he went, Baxter made a most remarkable statement about you.
He said, no doubt, that I was not really Ralston McTodd.
Yes.
It's quite true. I am not Ralston McTodd.
You admit it?
I'm proud of it.
Then what the deuce are you doing here under his name?
I was expecting you to ask that question. Primarily, I want no thanks. I did it to save you embarrassment.
You what?
When I came into the smoking room of our mutual club that afternoon, I found Comrade McTodd on the point of leaving your life forever. It seems he'd taken umbrage because you'd buzzed off to chat to that florist. He legged it, leaving you short one modern poet. I stepped into the breach to save you from the inconvenience of having to return home without a McTodd of any description.
Are you a member of the Senior Conservative Club?
Most certainly.
Well, then, dash it, you can't be a criminal. Baxter's an ass.
Exactly.
He would have it that you'd stolen my sister's necklace.
I can assure you that I have not got Lady Constance's necklace.
Of course not, my dear fellow. I'm merely telling you what that idiot Baxter said. Oh, thank goodness I got rid of him. Oh, goodness knows what I'm going to do without him.
You have touched on a matter which I'd intended to broach to you at some convenient moment when you were at leisure. If you would care to accept my services, they are at your disposal.
Well,
the fact is, I'm shortly about to be married, and it's more or less imperative that I connect with some job that will ensure a moderate competence. Why should I not become your secretary?
But I've never had a married secretary.
I think you'd find a steady married man an improvement on these wild flowerpot-throwing bachelors. If it would help to influence your decision, I may say that my bride-to-be is Miss Halliday. Huh? Probably the finest library cataloguist in the kingdom.
But I like her.
Excellent.
She's a nice girl.
I quite agree with you.
Huh. And have you any experience as a secretary?
I must admit that I have not. You see, until recently I was more or less of the idle rich. My name, perhaps I ought to reveal to you, is Smith. The P is silent. My name is probably unfamiliar to you, but you may have heard of the house which was for many years the Smith headquarters, Corfby Hall.
Corfby Hall? Are you the son of the Smith who used to own Corfby Hall? Bless my soul, I knew your father well.
Really?
Yes. That's to say, I never met him.
No?
No, but I won the first prize for roses at the Shrewsbury show the year he won the prize for tulips.
It seems to draw us very close together.
Why, my dear boy, if you're really looking for a position of some kind and like to be my secretary, nothing can suit me better. nothing. Why, bless my soul.
I'm extremely obliged, and I shall endeavour to give satisfaction. And now, if you'll excuse me, I think I'll go down and tell the glad news to your capable cataloguist, if I may so describe her.
Well, I think that just about cleans things up. Mind you, you can't think out plots like mine without getting the suspicion from time to time that something's gone seriously wrong with the brain's two hemispheres. Many is the time I've felt like crying out, "Oh, what a noble mind is here o'erthrown!" But we've got there at last. All that remains is to get Lord Emsworth, with his glasses on his nose where they ought to be, back into the gardens of his earthly paradise, which is where he's wanted to be since we started.
McAllister! We've got to have a serious talk about the hollyhocks.
Lord Emsworth was played by Michael Hordern, Beach by Ellis Dale, Joe Keeble, Brian Pringle, Miss Peavy, Zoe Wanamaker, Coots, Stuart Milligan, and McTodd, Peter Marinka. Susan, Alex Marshall, Briggs, Alan Dudley, newspaper employee, Hayden Wood, a young man, Spencer Banks, flowered waistcoat, Michael Spice, snuff-coloured suit, George Parsons, and a waiter, Ronald Herdman.
I knew there was something about him the moment I set eyes on him. Have you ever seen a poet who wears a monocle?
Baxter, Christopher Godwin.
I do not know what Blandings will be without you, Mr. Baxter.
Lady Constance, Joan Greenwood.
Why couldn't she have married me? I wish life was a bit more like the movies.
Freddie, David Troughton.
Go away. Eh? Go away.
Go away?
Yes, go away.
Right-o.
Unlike the male codfish, which, suddenly finding itself the parent of 3,500,000 little codfish, cheerfully resolves to love them all, the British aristocracy is apt to look with a somewhat jaundiced eye on its younger sons.
P.G. Wodehouse, John Gielgud.
Now, I wonder how one goes about cataloguing a library.
Eve, Caroline Langrish.
The whisper flies round the clubs. Smith has found his niche at last.
Smith, Simon Ward. Leave It to Smith was adapted by Michael Bakewell from the novel by P.G. Wodehouse. The play was directed by Peter King.